Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes is given in the PDF format in the description box and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is with respect to Hyperloop project in Maharashtra between Pune and Mumbai. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. So what do we mean when we say Hyperloop transportation? See, this is a new mode of transportation that takes both people and goods from one point to another directly, that is without any stops in between. One speciality of this transportation is with respect to the speed in which it can transport goods or people. Generally, what happens is that the passengers or the cargo, they will be loaded into the Hyperloop vehicle. Then the passenger vehicle or the freight vehicle will be floating above the track using magnetic levitation principle. And therefore, the passenger pod or the passenger vehicle will be gradually accelerated. This acceleration is done through electric propulsion in a low pressure tube. How this transport mechanism starts? See, this system uses a linear electric motor to start the transportation mechanism. This linear electric motor has two parts. One is the stator and the other is rotor. The stator electromagnets will be mounted on the tube, whereas the rotor will be mounted on the passenger vehicle. This passenger vehicle is also called as pod or passenger pod. So what happens? When electric current passes through these stator electromagnets, the rotor mounted on the passenger vehicle moves in a straight line along the length of the stator. So this is how the passenger vehicle moves from one point to another in a linear fashion. So once the passenger vehicle is floating above the track using the principle of magnetic levitation, then the vehicle will glide at airline speeds for long distances. Such speed is possible because of ultra low aerodynamic drag. So what do we mean when we say drag or aerodynamic drag? See, when an object moves in a fluid or when an object moves above a fluid, then the resistance force offered against the motion of that particular object is referred to drag. When this fluid is air, then the resistance offered is called as air resistance or aerodynamic drag. When this fluid is a liquid such as water, then the resistance offered is called as hydrodynamic drag. When we say hyperloop technology, there is combination of two things. One is magnetic levitation, then the second one is using low pressure environment along with vacuum sealed environment. In magnetic levitation, see, this technology is already used in monorails to lift the passenger parts and to move them along their rails. When we say magnetic levitation, first there will be floating of the passenger pod, then there will be acceleration of passenger pod. By using two sets of magnets, by using magnetic properties, this process is carried out. See, generally the term levitation means something floating in the air. They usually say by use of some magical powers. But here the passenger pod floats by the help of magnetic properties, and therefore it is called as magnetic levitation. See, one set of magnets repel the passenger pod from the track and lift the passenger pod upwards. And by electric propulsion, then the floated train will move at a considerable speed with reduced friction. Now, the speciality of magnetic levitation is that there is reduced friction. Here, when we say friction, we are referring to friction because of ground contact that can be seen in conventional trains. So in conventional trains, a lot of energy is lost because of ground contact friction. That is not the case with Hyperloop technology or Hyperloop transportation system. Now the second thing here is the use of low pressure environment and vacuum sealed environment. The air that is inside the tube will be removed using vacuum pumps. So what happens within the tube when the passenger pod moves from one place to another? There will be ultra low air resistance or very, very less air resistance. So usually when we see in conventional transportation system, say a train or a bus or a car, there will be two kind of resistances at a major level. One, the ground contact friction. The second is the air resistance. Now, in this transportation system, both are reduced to a very less level or ultra-low magnitude. So, these two are main reasons why here the speed is so much compared to, you know, a bus or a conventional train. So, what this news article mentions is that one of the important investors in the private company called as Virgin Hyperloop One Systems. This investor is set to meet the new chief minister of Maharashtra. He is set to clarify, provided if there are any misunderstandings or provided some clarification is required from the new government that is recently formed in Maharashtra. So at the global level, there are many private companies who are presently working on making this transportation system a reality. And Virgin Hyperloop One Systems is one such company. According to the company is working very hard so as to realize one Hyperloop project in at least one or two routes by the year 2021. Earlier in August 2019, the news was that Maharashtra state government had given approval for this company to establish one project that aims to bring transportation between Pune and Mumbai. It was mentioned that this transportation project, if becomes reality, then people can travel from Mumbai to Pune or Pune to Mumbai within 23 minutes. This is because the system is set to transport people at the speed of approximately 1100 km per hour or 700 miles per hour. This is because we know that it is operated in depressurized environment through magnetic levitation. And this transportation system will be built on columns, in normal terms we tell pillars, or it will be tunneled below the ground level. So why they are doing like this? This is to avoid dangerous road, railway crossings or grade crossings, and also not to disturb wildlife. While the work will definitely disturb wildlife, but maybe after completion of the work, wildlife will not be affected. And they are saying that it is fully autonomous and enclosed transportation system. So when it is fully autonomous, they are saying that there is elimination of pilot error. And since it is enclosed, so there will be no impact inside, or there will be very, very less impact because of weather-related hazards. And because it is happening in an enclosed environment, this particular transportation system can operate in any climatic conditions. See, the speed of 1100 km per hour means people can reach Delhi from Chennai within 2 hours. So normally if you take the flight timing between Chennai and Delhi, it is around 2 hours 45 minutes. So now if this system is constructed or established between Chennai and Delhi, which is very, very difficult with the present development in this transportation system, this time can be reduced to even less than 2 hours. So now come to Mumbai and Pune. So here, say for example, a person's workplace is Mumbai and he or she is residing near to his or her workplace. Now it takes 20-23 minutes to reach his or her workplace within Mumbai itself. Now in future, if such a system is established, people need not prefer to buy properties near their workplace. People need not worry about staying near workplace. People can stay even far outside, provided such a system is established. So this system establishes housing opportunities where people are no longer required to live close to their workplace. And one of the significance of this system is that there will be zero direct emissions. That is, there will not be direct emissions as we can witness emissions in two-wheelers or in petrol or diesel-fueled cars. So thereby it becomes a environment-friendly solution with respect to transportation. And that is why this suggestion becomes relevant in the form of environmental pollution and degradation in your GS3 syllabus. And know that this system requires very little energy to propel or to accelerate the passenger vehicles through the tubes. And this is because of the vacuum environment where there is little or very less air resistance. And this system is said to be 5 to 10 times more energy efficient than an aeroplane and very much faster than the conventional rail transportation systems. And one speciality here is that this system could be powered by renewable energies, for example, solar energy and wind energy. They will be integrating solar panel technology throughout the tube outwardly. So depending upon the climate, the integration of solar technology could generate around 2/3 of projected energy needs of a particular route. So though there will be heavy investment required as an input cost in the beginning, this system is supposed to have longer lifetimes and there will be lower operating costs because small amount of electricity is required to achieve extraordinary speeds, and people will be able to travel very much faster and also without noise, that is quieter. And as we saw already, people need not stay very closer to their workplace. So this will remove particularly the pressure from various cities, for example, Mumbai or Chennai or Kolkata or New Delhi. As a result, there will be reduction of internal migration and people can stay even far away. But know that the system is presently under development. And there is one another thing. At present, what the companies are saying is at one trip, around 20 to 25 people could be transported from one point to another. So these are some of the points. Maybe in future, more development will happen. And know that this transportation system is presently under development only. Now, with respect to Mumbai, the plan is that the project will be implemented in two phases. The first phase will be completed within 4 years, and the second phase will take another 4 years. I know that the Maharashtra government has already accorded infrastructure status to this Hyperloop project. That is how it becomes relevant under the infrastructure title in GS3 syllabus. So anyway, even if they start the work by now, it will take at least 8 years to realize this project so that one person can travel from Mumbai to Pune or Pune to Mumbai in this transportation system. Anyway, this new transportation system is going to become our part of life in the near future. And for India, we could expect two routes. So far, this company has selected to establish two routes in India. One is between Mumbai to Pune and vice versa. And the other route is Chennai to Bangalore and Bangalore to Chennai. So anyway, we can expect, if there is political will and if the system is safer for transportation, we can expect two routes by 2035 and additional routes by 2050. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. Now this data point article, it mentions some important statistical data indices with respect to the state of persecution in different countries. Talks about number of international migrants in India, talks about total refugees in our country, and it also mentions about two important indices that are released by Pew Research Center. These indices are called as Government Restrictions Index, then Social Hostilities Index. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. First, let us see some important terms, for example, like persecution, international migrants, then refugees. Then we'll also see about the Pew Research Center that publishes Government Restrictions Index and Social Hostilities Index. When we say persecution, we are referring to cruel or unfair treatment over a period of time. And this could be on the grounds of race, religion, political preference, ethnicity, even, you know, sexual orientation. It could be even on the basis of gender, caste, social status, political beliefs, and there could be more such grounds. Persecution may also include incitement to hate or an attempt to hate other persons on the basis of various parameters. Then it also includes hostile behavior, which is also known as unfriendliness. Then it also means imposing restrictions on a particular community or harassing a particular community or persons. Then it also includes arrest, imprisonment, torture, murder, execution, and other things. So here when we say arrest, here when we say imprisonment, when we say torture or murder, this could be on the basis of grounds such as race or religion or ethnicity. For example, just because a person belongs to a particular religion, he must be arrested, he must be tortured, he must be murdered, he must be imposed restrictions. So this is the understanding here when we say imprisonment or murder or imprisonment or torture. Now let us see one of the reactions as a result of persecution by various groups in a country or persecution by a government. What happens is the usual or habitual residents in a particular country, they will cross the international border to avoid persecution in their state or country. Now let us see the difference between the term migrant and refugee. Whether these two terms, refugee and migrant, can they be interchangeably used? See, the answer is no. This is because when we say migration, it has to be understood as a voluntary process. For example, someone who crosses a border in search of better economic opportunities, and such a person can also return to their home safely. It is these persons who are called as migrants. But when we talk about refugees, they are unable to return to their homeland or home safely. So this is the difference, even though the process involved is migration. So therefore, refugees are specifically defined and they are protected in international law and also in international human rights standards. So refugees are people who are living outside their country of origin. And the reason could be feared persecution because of conflict in their country of origin, because of violence in their country of origin, and because of some other circumstances in their country of origin that have seriously disturbed public order. In the light of this definition, human rights defenders and some international experts in migration and refugees, they are saying that those persons who came to India, even though they are Muslims from Bangladesh or from East Pakistan, in the years of 1970, 71, 72, they have to be considered as refugees because at that time, the East Pakistan or the early Bangladesh was suffering from a lot of conflicts and violent activities. So these refugees, after crossing their national borders, they seek safety in the nearby countries or in the countries where they migrate to. So when these persons are recognized as refugees, they will be able to access the assistance from the countries and also from United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. See, this United Nations Refugee Agency or the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, it is a global organization that is dedicated for refugees. They will save the lives of refugees. They will protect the rights and future of refugees who are living outside their country of origin. Now, there is also an international convention of refugees called as UN Convention of Refugees. See, this convention was formed on July 28, 1951, and the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees was appointed as the guardian of this convention. And in 1967, a comprehensive protocol was framed. The purpose was to extend the jurisdiction of UNHCR, and thereby, with this protocol, this body has become an overarching body or a comprehensive body at the international level to protect the rights of refugees. Here, when we discuss this convention, what we have to keep in mind is whether India has signed this convention, whether India is party to this convention. See, India has neither signed this 1951 convention nor the 1967 protocol. Therefore, India is not party to this convention or the 67 protocol, and it does not have a national refugee protection framework, or it does not have a national refugee policy as well. So how the refugees in India are maintained or taken care of? See, India gives asylum to a large number of refugees from neighboring states. And if you see the standards that we have adopted with respect to the refugees of various countries, it is based on certain human rights standards. At the same time, it also respects the mandate of United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. And the existing standards with respect to refugees in India do respect or adhere to some of the provisions of 1951 Convention. See, the United Nations Convention defines the term refugee. It mentions that those persons who are unable to return to their country of origin, or those persons who are unwilling to return to their country of origin because of a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, membership of a particular social group, for example, a particular caste, or even political opinion. This is the definition given for the term refugee by the 1951 United Nations Convention on Refugees. Now let's see about this Pew Research Center. The agency mentions it as a non-partisan fact tank, and it operates from Washington, D.C. Here the term fact tank, we can relate it to think tank. So this Pew Research Center plays a main role in disseminating information to the public on various issues, attitudes and trends that can be observed around the world on various spheres. It conducts public opinion polling, demographic research, content analysis and various other data-driven social science research. And today's article is with respect to one of its activities where it releases two important indices called as the Government Restrictions Index and the Social Hostilities Index. Now, if you take the Government Restrictions Index, it measures the provisions in some of the countries that restrict religious beliefs and practices. Here, when we say provisions, it takes into consideration whether there is any law that is used to restrict persons belonging to certain religion or whether there is any policy, whether it also even assesses the actions by the government officials in restricting persons belonging to a particular religious belief, who those who follow a particular religious practice. If you take Social Hostilities Index, it measures religious hostility by private individuals, organizations, and also various groups in the society. While the first index is with respect to government, this index is with respect to private individuals, organizations, and groups in the society. Both these indices are measured in a 10-point scale. So the more the value, it indicates more the persecution. That is, when the value is higher, it indicates there is more persecution in a particular nation. And the data point also talks about the Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2019 that has been passed by both the houses of the parliament. So once president gives the assent, it is to become an enforceable piece of legislation. See, as we know already, this bill aims to provide citizenship for Hindus, Christians, Jains, Parsis, Sikhs and Buddhists who have migrated to India from three neighboring countries, Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh. If you observed the parliament proceedings, the Union Home Minister has mentioned that these are the communities who have faced persecution in the Muslim majority countries such as Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh, and therefore he has justified offering citizenship to these religious communities excluding the Muslims. We are mentioning that this is how the Home Minister has justified bringing this bill. Now, if you see this data point, it states that as per the United Nations estimates, there are more than 51 lakh international migrants in India. And among them, more than 2 lakh people were recognized as refugees under the 1951 convention by the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. If you look at the data point, you can identify most of the migrants are from Bangladesh to the tune of around 31 lakh migrants, while most of the refugees are from China, particularly from Tibet. Now let's see about the religious hostility in different countries with the help of this Government Restrictions Index and also the Social Hostilities Index. Except Bhutan and Nepal, every other neighboring country has had higher SHI or GRI, therefore indicates greater persecution of minorities in these countries. Even if you take India, India is also having a higher government restriction index to the tune of 5.1, and the social hostility index is 9.7 out of 10. This indicates the higher level of persecution in our country. Now the third aspect dealt by this data point, you can see it asks whether there was harassment by the government agencies towards religious or ethnic groups. The table 1 indicates yes and 0 indicates no. That is, 1 indicates yes, there is harassment by government authorities. 0 indicates no harassment from the side of the government. When we say government here, it could mean any government representative. Say a person goes to a particular office to get a government service, whereas he faces discrimination or unfair treatment. This could also be considered as persecution. If you see in Myanmar, even some section of majority religion, that is in Buddhism, even they are also facing the harassment. All communities, according to this Pew report, all communities except Jews are facing harassment in Myanmar. In case of India and Nepal, the report notes that there is Dalit persecution under Hinduism. Now, for our better understanding, we have to take it as persecution to the persons belonging to the scheduled castes. Now, this has to be interpreted as, in India, there is unfair or cruel treatment to the persons belonging to scheduled castes from the government authorities. So these are some of the information you can take from the analysis of this data point news article. Now let us move on to next news article. This news article is with respect to the study conducted by the Central Water Commission with respect to heavy metal and trace elements contamination in some specific rivers. Recently, the Central Water Commission has published the status of trace and toxic metals in Indian rivers 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been given here for your reference. See, when we say pollution in water bodies, particularly surface water bodies or even the soil, heavy metals are one of the most important and widespread causes of pollution, both in water and also in soil. And there are also some metals which are called as trace metals. See, these are elements that normally occur at very low levels in the environment. Even human beings, we need very small amounts of some trace metals. But know that high levels of even trace metals can be toxic to human beings. Now coming to heavy metals, what do we mean by heavy metals? Or what is the definition for it? The definition that is given in this status that is published by Central Water Commission is that heavy metals are metals with high atomic number, metals with high atomic weight, and metals with a density greater than 5 gram per cubic centimeter or 5 gram per centimeter cube. So there are around some 35 metals that are considered dangerous for human health. Of these, 23 metals come under heavy metal category. So we have given you the list here. So these are the heavy metals that are dangerous for human health when they are beyond the safe limit. However, given all these 23 heavy metals, major lethal effects to human health are caused by few heavy metals such as lead, cadmium, mercury, and arsenic. Now, what may happen if there are large amounts of such metals in human body or consumable drinking water? What can happen? See, this will obviously lead to acute toxicity or severe toxicity or chronic toxicity. That is, water that you take every day will be toxic in nature. What will be the result of this toxicity? See, there will be medical conditions or health conditions in human beings. For example, damaged or reduced mental functions, damaged or reduced central nervous functions, modified blood composition. There could be damages to the lung, kidney, liver, and other important organs of human body. See, other than these four heavy metals, there are five other major pollutants. They are chromium, copper, iron, nickel, and zinc. We have given you the major sources of these nine pollutants in the form of a table here. Here you can notice some of the sources are anthropogenic in nature. That is, they are released into the environment because of human beings. For example, automobile emissions for lead, mining activities, industrial activities, and many other sources. Now let's come to the news article. See, Central Water Commission has released a publication called as Status of Trace and Toxic Metals in Indian Rivers 2019. See, this is the third edition of such release of status report with respect to trace and toxic metals in Indian rivers. And this report has been published by the Central Water Commission. The news article mentions that the study has been conducted in around 67 rivers that comes under 20 river basins. See, at the national level, India is divided into 20 river basins that consist of 12 major basins and 8 composite river basins. Now, with respect to major basins, we have Indus Basin, Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna Basin, Godavari Basin, Krishna Basin, Kaveri Basin, Mahanadi Basin, Pennar Basin, Brahmani Baitarani Basin, Sabarmati Basin, Mahi Basin, Narmada Basin, Tapi Basin. Each of these major basins, they have a drainage area more than 20,000 square kilometers. Whereas if you see the composite river basins, these basins consist of medium and small river systems. With respect to composite river basins, we have Subarnarekha Basin, then east flowing rivers between Mahanadi and Pennar, then east flowing rivers between Pennar and Kanyakumari, then area of inland drainage in Rajasthan Desert, then west flowing rivers of Kutch and Saurashtra including Luni River, then west flowing rivers from Tapi to Tadri or Tadri, then west flowing rivers from Tadri to Kanyakumari, and finally minor rivers that drains into Myanmar and Bangladesh. This third edition of the status report is said to be a revised and a comprehensive edition with data of 8 elements: arsenic, cadmium, chromium, copper, iron, lead, nickel, and zinc. And the assessment period is from May 2014 to April 2018. These water samples were taken from various water quality monitoring stations, which are based on various rivers. Water samples were taken and they were tested for toxic and trace metals as per IS standards of Bureau of Indian Standards. And the samples were collected in 3 different seasons: pre-monsoon season, monsoon season, and post-monsoon season. Here, when we say monsoon season, we are referring to southwest monsoon season. Most important finding of the study or the survey or the status report is that samples from only 33% of water quality monitoring stations were safe. That means remaining 2/3 of water quality monitoring stations, that is around 65% of samples, were polluted by one or more heavy metals. Here, when we say polluted, we are referring to the fact that the safe limits with respect to these pollutants were exceeded. That is, they are more than the limits prescribed by Bureau of Indian Standards. Now, another finding is that in all the sites, the arsenic level and mercury level are within the safe limit. What is the most common contaminant in Indian rivers based on this study is iron. Some of the other major contaminants that were found in the samples were lead, nickel, chromium, cadmium, copper. This study also found out a marked variation in the contamination levels with respect to seasons as well. And one thing to note, not all the rivers were equally sampled. Several rivers were sampled at one particular site, whereas other rivers, for example, Ganga, Yamuna and Godavari, they were sampled at multiple sites. So these are some of the important information that we can take from this survey. There will be more news articles in the upcoming days that will come with respect to the recently released status of Indian rivers with respect to contamination levels from trace and heavy metals. Now let's see few information with reference to the Central Water Commission. See, this CWC is the premier technical organization in our country with respect to the field of water resources. It is functioning under the Ministry of Jal Shakti. So in the field of water resources, the apex organization is the Central Water Commission. Now, this commission came into existence way back in 1945, even before the independence. At that time, it was called as Central Waterways, Irrigation and Navigation Commission. If you see, in the year 1951, it was renamed as Central Water and Power Commission. It was called like this after the merger with Central Electricity Commission. It was in 1974 when it was called as Central Water Commission. This is because it was in that year the water wing of Central Water and Power Commission was separated. Since 1974, the name Central Water Commission continues till date. Now, if you see the main activities of Central Water Commission, there are several activities. We'll see three or four important activities. The first responsibility is that it has to initiate, it has to coordinate various schemes for control, conservation and utilization of water resources in consultation with state governments. And these schemes could be with respect to flood management, irrigation, drinking water supply and water power generation. And if required, the commission can even undertake the construction and execution of such scheme. The next most important task is to undertake necessary surveys and investigations as and when required, so as to prepare some schemes or designs with respect to development of river valleys. Here also the purpose could be, you know, power generation, environmental management, soil conservation, drinking water supply, reclamation of soils and other measures. See, it is with respect to this particular task, the Central Water Commission has recently released the status report with respect to contamination levels in Indian rivers. Now then it can undertake construction work of any river valley development scheme, either on behalf of the central government or on behalf of the state government. And whenever required, it can advise and also assist both the central government and also the state governments, whenever the matter is with respect to water resources development. And even it can advise central government with respect to rights and disputes between different states that can affect conservation and utilization of water resources. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article is with respect to recent initiatives that are being undertaken by the Andhra Pradesh state government so as to contain various offenses that are committed against women and children. News reports are saying that the Andhra Pradesh is in the process of enacting three legislations. One is Andhra Pradesh Disha Bill 2019, Andhra Pradesh Criminal Law Amendment Bill of 2019, and finally Andhra Pradesh Special Code for Specified Offenses Against Women and Children Bill 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. The main objective of these legislations is to ensure speedy delivery of justice for victims of specified offenses against women and children, particularly sexual offenses. Generally, when we hear news reports about heinous crimes against women and children, there will be formal and informal reactions to such offenses. When we say informal reactions, one example could be the protests that are being carried out by the people. And coming to formal reactions, this comes in the form of amendment from the side of the government. So the measures that are initiated by the Andhra Pradesh government becomes part of formal reactions against the recent incidents, sexual offenses against women and children. Know that right to justice for a victim is a fundamental right under Article 21 of Indian Constitution. Effective and timely justice delivery is a very important factor that determines the trust and hope of people in the judicial system of the country. So a judicial system is required to provide justice in a timely manner and also in an effective manner, at least in the case of heinous crimes such as sexual assault against women and children and other sexual offenses against women and children. And our judicial system was also criticized with respect to delayed justice delivery. And there is also a quote, delayed justice is nothing but injustice. And as a result, our judicial system is criticized as suffering from a slow motion syndrome. One reason is because it is taking several years to deliver a verdict in some of the sensitive and important cases. There are several reasons why much delay happens in trials in courts. Now, one important reason is with respect to huge pendency in courts. And why there is huge pendency in courts with respect to various cases? This is because of poor judge to population ratio. When there is lack of enough judges with respect to population or with respect to the number of cases registered, this increases the burden on each judge. So this affects the quality of verdicts that are delivered by the judges. And this pressure is even more when the vacancies are not filled in the timely manner by the governments. Now, one another reason is with respect to poor infrastructure in the lower courts. See, whenever a case of murder is registered or whenever a case of sexual assault is registered in the police station, this case has to be prosecuted in the court of sessions, which comes in hierarchy compared to high courts. Every district will have a court of session. But in such lower courts, such sessions courts, it is noted that there are not enough infrastructure available. For example, sufficient judicial and non-judicial staff are not available. Technical and non-technical staff are not available. Reasonable spaces within courts are not available. And there is also lack of libraries in some of the courts. For these things, there has to be increase in government expenditure. And this point is a qualitative measure with respect to effective and quality and timely service delivery. One more important thing to ensure speedy justice is to constitute special courts to deal specifically with respect to particular offenses. While this will help in delivering justice without delay, this will also reduce the pendency of such cases in normal courts. And then there is also criticism with respect to giving adjournments on unreasonable grounds in several cases. This is also one reason for delay in delivery of justice. This has to be taken care of. There has to be some measure of supervision and monitoring on this adjournment procedures. While more importantly, whenever there is a delay in courts, the judge population ratio and various other parameters have been discussed. One main important factor that determines efficient and quick conclusion of a case is the quality of investigation and timely conclusion of investigation by the police. We have discussed the role of police in investigation and the role of police in criminal justice system in detail day before yesterday, that is on 10th December 2019, when we discussed one editorial titled as "A Growing Blot on the Criminal Justice System." And we also discussed the case law of PUCL versus State of Maharashtra. The link has been given in the description. You are advised to have a visit in these lectures to better understand the role of police in the criminal justice system, particularly what are the various guidelines with respect to an encounter incident. Now, while these are some of the important reasons and solutions we have discussed side by side with respect to pendency, delay in justice delivery, the recent measures taken by the Cabinet of Andhra Pradesh State Government is a step in the right direction because these measures seeks to award death penalty for the offences of penetrative sexual assault, rape and gang rape. Some of the important measures are significant in the history of our country with respect to verdict in a particular case. The steps that are to be taken by Andhra Pradesh government includes completion of investigation in 7 days and completion of trial in 14 days. So totally within 21 days, judgment has to be delivered. And this has to be done according to various news sources from the day of case registration. That is, once FIR is filed, immediately the accused has to be arrested. Within 7 days, investigation has to be completed and police have to submit charge sheet in the court. And within next 14 days, trial should complete and a final verdict has to be delivered. This will ensure speedy justice for the victim and it will prevent crimes in future, because swift, certain and proportionate lawful punishment will create deterrence. Deterrence is nothing but the fear of punishment. Here, the fear of certainty of punishment, that a person understands that definitely he will be punished, and fear of swift punishment, that a person, that is the offender, understands that definitely, quickly he will be punished, and the fear of proportionate punishment. For example, in the case of heinous crimes, the person may definitely get death penalty. The measures aim to deal with offenses against women and children. As we saw, rape, gang rape, acid attacks, stalking, voyeurism, you know, sexual harassment, and some cases and offenses under the Protection of Children from Sexual Offenses Act as well. The measures aims to establish special courts to deal category of offenses that are to be mentioned in these bills, so that for these cases, quickly justice may be delivered. Particularly, the Criminal Amendment Bill aims to amend Indian Penal Code of 1860. And the Criminal Law Amendment Bill is said to be introducing two new provisions called as Section 354 Capital E and 354 Capital F. 354 Capital E would deal with harassment of women through social media, digital mode or any other platform. Punishment would be imprisonment for a period up to 2 years on first conviction and 4 years on second and subsequent convictions. Section 354 Capital F would deal with molestation or sexual assault of children. Here the punishment would be imprisonment for a period of minimum of 5 years on first conviction. Well, these are some of the measures that are historic and unprecedented. What we have to look into is, what about the responsibility of police and the prosecution authorities? For example, what if a police team is unable to complete investigation within 7 days? What if police could not complete investigation? What if police delays in submission of charge sheet even after for more period of time? Whether there is any kind of negative reinforcement for them? What is the role of public prosecutor? What if he or she is not efficiently arguing for victim in the court of law against a well-paid private defense lawyer? So the legislative measures should definitely address these things, so that these recent measures will create fear among the offenders, at least within the territory of Andhra Pradesh. Now, how can Andhra Pradesh enact such amendments in Indian Penal Code? See, if you see Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution, the first entry of concurrent list is criminal law, that is Indian Penal Code. Second entry is criminal procedure, that is Code of Criminal Procedure. So these two being in concurrent list, both the center and state can enact laws on these two subjects. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. This question, Government Restrictions Index is released by. See, the correct answer for this question is option B, Pew Research Center. Now, one another index released by this center is Social Hostilities Index. See, it's a non-partisan think tank or fact tank that operates from Washington, D.C., wherein this Government Restrictions Index, it measures the laws, policies and actions by government officials that restrict religious beliefs and practices. And in case of Social Hostilities Index, it measures the religious hostility by private individuals, private organizations or groups in the society. And with respect to these indices, if the value is high, it indicates more persecution. So the correct answer is option B. Now, if you see Reporters Without Borders, they release World Press Freedom Index. And with respect to Stockholm International Peace Research Institute, they maintain military expenditure database. And the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, this office releases Global Trends Report. See, UN High Commissioner for Refugees is called as UN Refugee Agency. Now, this is the organization that is dedicated to protecting the rights and Future for Refugees. This Global Trends report is published every year. In this report, the High Commissioner for Refugees counts and tracks the number of refugees, number of internally displaced people, and number of people who have returned to their countries or areas of origin. It talks about, it deals with asylum seekers, stateless people, and other populations of concern with respect to UN Refugee Agency. Now, this UN High Commissioner for Refugees is the guardian of 1951 UN Convention on Refugees that deals with all aspects of protection of refugees. India neither signed this convention, nor India signed the 1967 protocol with respect to this convention. So India is not party to this UN Convention on Refugees. So the correct answer for this question is option B. Now this question is with reference to Central Water Commission. They have given two statements and asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, the Central Water Commission has its beginning even before the independence. We have seen that the statement is correct. See, the Central Water Commission has been serving the nation since 1945. We know that it is the apex organization in our country in the field of water resources, and it came into existence in the year 1945. At that time, it was called as Central Waterways Irrigation and Navigation Commission. In 1951, it was merged with the Central Electricity Commission, and then it was renamed as Central Water and Power Commission. Then in the year 1974, the water wing of this Central Water and Power Commission was separated, and that water wing came to be called as Central Water Commission. So it has its beginning since 1945. So the first statement is correct. You can eliminate option B and option D. Now the second statement, National Water Academy functions directly under the guidance of the chairman of Central Water Commission. Now this statement is correct. See, the National Water Committee was set up in the Central Water Commission by the Ministry of Water Resources in the year 1988. The task of this academy is to impart training to the in-service engineers of various central and state organizations who are involved in the development and management of water resources. Earlier, it was called as the Central Training Unit. So this statement is also correct. So the correct answer for this question is both 1 and 2. This question is with reference to the status of trace and toxic metals in Indian rivers 2019 released by the Central Water Commission. So as per the Central Water Commission's status of trace and toxic metals in Indian rivers 2019, consider the following statements. They have given three statements asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, iron is the most common contaminant found in Indian rivers. This statement is correct based on this survey. The second statement, the concentration of sodium chloride is very high in all the rivers in India. Now, the statement is given just to confuse the aspirants. See, the study is about trace and toxic metals. That too, only 8 metals such as arsenic, cadmium, chromium, copper, iron, lead, nickel, and zinc. But whatever given here is a salt sodium chloride. So you can easily eliminate statement 2 as incorrect statement. So once you decide statement 2 as incorrect, you can easily arrive at the correct answer. Option C, 1 and 3 only is the correct answer. Now the third statement is also correct because 2/3 of the water quality monitoring stations sampled for this survey was found polluted by one or more heavy metals. This is one of the important findings by this status report. So the correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now this question is with reference to the Hyperloop transportation system. They have given three statements asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, it is operated using the magnetic levitation principle. Now this statement is correct. Therefore, you can eliminate option B, 2 and 3. Here, using the magnetic properties, the passenger vehicle will be lifted upwards and it will be floating above the track. This they will achieve by using a set of magnets. One set of magnet will repel the train from the track and lift upwards. Then using electric propulsion, the passenger pod will move in a linear fashion. This is because the system uses a linear electric motor to start the transport mechanism. This electric motor will have stator and rotor. The rotor will be mounted on the vehicle. The stator will be mounted on the inside of the tube. So when electric current passes, the rotor which is mounted on the passenger vehicle will move in a straight line along the length of the stator. So this is how it operates. So the first statement is correct. The second state mentions that it uses ion calorimeter detector. We know that this detector is also called as iCal detector. We will be studying about ion calorimeter detector whenever we study about India-based neutrino project, wherein this detector will be used to study about neutrinos that are emanated from various natural and laboratory sources. However, this detector has no role to play in this hyperloop transportation system. So once you eliminate the statement 2, once you are clear that statement 2 is a wrong statement, you can arrive at the correct answer, option A, 1 and through, by eliminating option B, option C and option D. So the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 and 3. Now see the third statement. A hyperloop project has been approved by the Maharashtra state government for direct connectivity between Mumbai and Pune. Now this statement is correct. We have given this point for revision purposes. So the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 and 3. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar AIS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We'll meet you tomorrow.